Welcome to this space and enjoy. And I'm going to just call on the moderator, introduce Maggie Ziegler, who is a resident of Salt Spring Island. She is a psychotherapist and an educator with a long history of involvement in community and non-for-profit organizations, both at home and internationally.
People's territory. And here we acknowledge that we're in the traditional territory of the Wasenich people, who signed treaties with James Douglas in the 1850s. Wasenich oral history tells us their chiefs made treaty with colonial authorities to avoid war and not to give up their lands. Specifically, this writing is home to the Sartlet, the Paquachin, the Seo, and the Sikkim. And we support the right of Aboriginal people to self-determination and want to express our commitment to the long-term process of reconciliation. I know we're all eager to get to the speakers and to hear what they have to say, but I'd like to just give a few minutes to representatives from a Dogwood Initiative and BCSEA who have conceptualized and hosted a series of five debates on energy and climate. This is the last one. So thank you so much. And first of all, Tim Roberts from BCSEA.
Thanks, Maggie, and good evening to you all. Thanks so much for coming, all of you. Chicken Little was right. The sky has been falling in. Without several decades of wing flapping by millions of chicken littles to focus attention on global warming, we'd be in an even sorrier state than we are right now. But we can't put all our eggs in that strategic basket. Flapping can become downright exhausting and depressing. Let's crow about solutions. They are happening at an astounding rate around the world and here in BC. Solar, wind, geothermal, and other non-fossil fuel energy solutions, energy efficiency and retrofitting solutions, community planning and transportation solutions. innovative financing, taxation, and regulatory approaches may not be all that sexy, but they're also critical. And when we embrace these solutions, climate action is not a burden. It's an historic opportunity. BCSEA exists to advance these solutions at every level. This is why, in this election year, our chapter has made it a priority to foster informed debate on approaches and solutions in the federal sphere. We are nonpartisan. We've made every effort to secure the participation of all four major parties in this debate, and deeply appreciate that Alicia, Elizabeth, and Tim are here tonight. I'm sorry that the Conservatives said that they have a conflict tonight. We could not have undertaken this initiative alone. We have 27 fabulous volunteers helping us here tonight. We would also like to acknowledge the support of our sponsors who are shown on the screens above, not right now, but they have been. Van City Credit Union, CFAX, Generation Squeeze, and Moksha Yoga. And locally, we appreciate the wonderful refreshments that were donated by Level Ground Trading, Breadstuffs Bakery, and Moulin Vert Bakery. On the BCSEA side, I would personally like to acknowledge Marianne Pape, who's hiding in the little alcove there. She is our chapter president, and it's her vision that has guided this series. And also, I'd like to acknowledge the indefatigable work of Tom Hackney, who is also in blue at the back here, too, BCSEA's policy director, in planning the format and questions for this debate. And then there are our partners. I'd like to turn the mic over to Alexis White, our representing our amazing, invaluable partner, the Dogwood Initiative. And she will introduce her organization and in turn, our other key partners in the faith community who've also been critical in this whole endeavor. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. Welcome, everyone. It's been a privilege to co-organize this debate with the visionary BCSEA team and our partners in the faith community, EcoVision, the Unitarian Church, and our amazing hosts, David Drake and Margaret Harper, here at St. Paul's, to provide this wonderful venue for tonight's debate, along with your assistance of their technical wizard, Anil Lau. They have all gone the extra mile to make this event happen, and so I'd like to give them a real thank you for what they've done. At Dogwood, we have the vision that every citizen in BC should have the right to be included in the decision-making process around any project or development that will adversely affect our land, our rivers, and precious coastal waters, and will ultimately contribute to climate change. It's been inspiring to see that over a quarter of a million Dogwood supporters throughout BC have pledged to take a stand in order to protect the health and well-being of our communities for years to come. What unites all of us is our love for this extraordinary place we are so privileged to call home, and a shared concern for our communities, our country, and our planet in the face of global crisis. And we're looking forward to hearing the candidates talk about this pressing issue and other topics tonight. Thank you for joining us tonight for this necessary discussion. And I invite all of you to stop by the Dogwood table after the debate, sign the vote pledge if you haven't had a chance to do so. Thank you.
Of housekeeping and then some guidelines, and then we'll just jump right into it. Washrooms are just down the hall here to the right and then the right again. Fire exits the back, here, and over there. I don't know if anyone's looking for childcare, but if you are, again, down the hall to the right and on the left. Photographs, flashes are okay. If it gets to be too disruptive, then prerogative to ask you to turn the flashes off. In terms of our guidelines, we ask you to put your phones on silent, to leave the room if you want to take a call or make a call. We're going to have a very short stretch break, 5 minutes max. So please feel free to get up and use the washrooms when you need to, or to get a coffee, or to write a question. You'll see there's people with pieces of paper standing around. Can you just wave the people who have theirs somewhere at the back? So if you want to write a question for the second half of the evening, just put up your hand and one of those people will deliver you a piece of paper and a pencil. So we really encourage a respectful exchange and listening between the candidates and between the candidates and the audience. We've created a really strong structure that I think is really going to give us a way to get to the issues in a way that we can really hear and listen from everybody. And we're going to finish by 9 o'clock, so that's another reason why just take care of yourself as you need to as we go along. So, here's how it's going to go. The candidates are each going to have a 2-minute opening statement, and then there's going to be 6 rounds of questions, which are pre-written questions. The candidates have all seen them, and they will each get to speak to 2 minutes to those questions and have a choice of a 30-second rebuttal. And I'll emphasize this timekeeping again in a moment. These topics of these questions will relate to Canada's share of GHG emissions reductions, Enbridge and the Kinder Morgan pipelines, the National Energy Board, sustainable energy, green jobs, and lastly, fair treatment for the next generations. So we have a noble timekeeper here. His name is Jack. And I'm going to ask him right now to wave in the air the 30-second thing. So you can see it from all sides. It cannot be missed. And when those 30 seconds are finished, he's going to put up the stop sign. And I'm going to ring the bell. So that's how it's going to go. And when we get to the question period, which will be after our short break, we'll go over the structure for that. So just to say now that in that second half, we will be alternating questions from the mic and questions that have been written. So we hope to get through 8 to 10 questions. It depends on time, but we'll come back to that. I wanted to ask, we have one candidate in this riding who's not at the table here. Meghan Porter is a Libertarian candidate. Just wanted to ask, is she here? Not here. Okay. I was going to invite her to come to the head of the line at question period. So if anyone knows her, if she shows up, please pass on that message. Okay, I think we're ready to go. The speaker's order has been predetermined and gives each candidate equal opportunity of going first and second. And it's been done by lot. And I think you guys have a paper, but if you don't have any, you're going to be surprised each time. So for these opening statements, we're going to go Elizabeth, Tim, Alicia, so straight down the table. Okay, the first question. This December, at the United Nations Climate Change Conference in Paris.
Opening statement.
Opening statement.
Thank you.
That was a test.
You're really paying attention. However, what I said is in fact in order for the opening statement. So I got it 50% right. Okay, Elizabeth.
Thanks. Well, I want to start by thanking the organizers as well. BC Sustainable Energy Association, the Dogwood Initiative. Boy, this feels really loud. Is this really loud?
Yes,
loud. Okay, and of course, to all the other partner and sponsoring organizations, and Maggie for moderating. The questions that we're going to have next, we'll get into policy and platform in some detail. So I'm going to actually approach this as if it wasn't an election campaign. And I was just talking about why climate change is the defining issue for all of us, and certainly is the driving force in my life. I would never have gone to politics if I hadn't been driven by concern about the climate crisis. I actually have the great benefit of learning my climate science before the myth of doubt was invented by the fossil fuel lobby. I learned my climate science in the mid-80s when, through complete fluke, since I wasn't a member of that party, I was recruited into the office of the Federal Minister of Environment to serve as senior policy advisor to Tom McMillan in the Brian Mulroney administration. I organized the first International Scientific Conference on Climate Change. It took place in the last week of June, 1988. We invited scientists from all around the world, and they put together a consensus statement. The conference, by the way, was called Our Changing Atmosphere, Implications for Global Security. I wish we kept the focus on security. Politicians seem to care about security, but not necessarily about the climate. The opening sentence of the consensus statement was this: humanity is conducting an unintended, uncontrolled, globally pervasive experiment whose ultimate consequences could be second only to global nuclear war. Nothing has changed, we haven't acted, and the deadline for action is coming up 40 days after this election.
Thank you to the organizers of the Maggies and my fellow candidates for being here. This is an important election. This afternoon I was talking to a friend and told him, I'm coming to this debate tonight. And he said, what? You're going to that Dogwood sustainable energy debate? Isn't that going to be a love-in for the Green Party and the NDP? And I said, I don't know. Maybe it is. But you know something? I don't care. Because I'm a liberal, and liberals listen, and we take advice, and we take advice from scientists. So I'm so pleased to be here to hear from you and to answer the questions that I'm able to answer. And so what I want to do now is to tell you a little bit about myself. I grew up in a family of nine. I was the eldest of nine. My father was a union leader and a strong NDP advocate. I worked on the NDP candidates' campaigns in Windsor, Ontario, many years. But then I came to my senses, you might say. But it was driven by the Right Honorable Herb Ray, who I've likened to Miss May in the way that that gentleman, parliamentarian, handled his constituency. I want to do the same here for you. I believe that we are in a crisis and that we need someone at the government's table to make sure that we get action on climate change. And that's what I want to do for you. Besides fighting hard for fully funding healthcare, because I know how important that is. I'm a grandfather and a father of three, and I understand that that's important to us. So I'll talk more about that later. Thank you.
Is that on?
Yes.
Oh, good. Thank you to everyone for being here this evening, and thank you to our organizers for allowing us this opportunity to discuss one of the most important elections in Canada's history. And I appreciate the recognition that we're on the Wasatch traditional territory, and for that I'm grateful for the privilege. I'm Alicia Cormier, your NDP candidate, and I've lived in this riding since 1969. I grew up in Sydney, and I've raised my family, worked, and volunteered in our community for over 30 years. I offer management experience in education, in healthcare, small business, and social enterprise. And I've been twice elected as a municipal councillor in Central Saanich. While serving on local government, I've been an outspoken voice promoting climate action, local agriculture, affordable housing, smart growth, and a healthy environment. Recently, I played a key role in a decision by the former council in Central Saanich, whereby they had wanted to designate rural land for future commercial and residential development. And this plan was not consistent with our regional sustainability strategy or our official community plan. And I'm proud to say that my efforts made a difference to protect several hectares of arable farmland and 14 small farms that are located there. I also founded the Saanich Peninsula chapter of Green Drinks. I'm running in this election because I can no longer sit by and watch Mr. Harper dismantling the country that I love. And I want to establish an NDP government for the first time in Canada's history, with Tom Mulcair as Prime Minister. We have a unique opportunity to address issues like climate change and growing inequality, not by advocating progressive policies, but by actually forming government that will implement these policies. With your support on October 19th, we will form government and make Canada a better place. Thank you.
I see some action to try to resolve the microphone that was a little jerky for you there. So
it's consistent. They mispronounce his name and all the light that's on the press.
That's true.
They often mispronounce your name.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. I'm used to
that. So let's see if I can start with question one and not question three. This December, at the United Nations Climate Change Conference in Paris, the nations of the world will meet once again with the goal of reaching, in the words of France's foreign minister, an ambitious, binding agreement on climate change that applies to all countries, enabling us to limit global warming to below 2 degrees Celsius. Meanwhile, the harm of climate change is ever more apparent. BC, Alberta, Saskatchewan have been ravaged by wildfires this summer, with thousands of people forced from their homes and many homes burned. Western North America and Brazil suffered record-breaking droughts, while parts of Eastern North America were hit by unseasonable rain and storms. And so it goes around the world. Canada and the world have failed to meet previous promises to cut carbon emissions. We can't afford to fail this time. The question is, what will you and your party do to ensure that Canada makes its share of the emissions reductions needed to achieve the goal of the Copenhagen Accord and limit global warming to below 2 degrees? And the order is, I have it by party, not by name, so I'm just going to read it that way. It's easier. Liberal, NDP, Green, and the rebuttal will be in the same order.
Right.
So, Tim.
Thank you, Maggie. The question, didn't have time on it, thankfully. But the fact is, the question is so absolutely true. We are in a crisis. We know that. And the Liberal Party has a plan to take on the challenge. Our leader, Justin Trudeau, has made it clear that if he's elected and he's able to form government, he will attend the Climate Change Conference in Paris in December, and he will invite all of the premiers to attend with him. It's almost novel to think that the premiers and the prime minister would get together after the last few years of Mr. Harper's regime, but that's what we'll do. From 90 days from that conference, Mr. Trudeau will meet with all the premiers once again to set national emission standard targets, reduction targets, and we're not going to impose a certain system like fee and dividend, cap and trade. Those are options, but in BC we have carbon tax already. That's what our province has chosen to do. So we're not going to be imposing the method, but what we're going to be imposing are the targets. And our federal government will help the provinces to meet those targets. Thank you.
Thank you. Under Harper's watch, the Conservatives have withdrawn from the Kyoto Protocol. They've muzzled scientists, and they fired over 4,000 federal researchers and slashed $1.1 billion in federal spending on science and technology just in the last 4 years alone. So I'd like you to imagine on October 20th, if the NDP wins more seats than the Conservatives, this is what we'll do. Tom Mulcair and his team will go to Paris, and we will sign a binding agreement to reduce carbon emissions. And the plan that we have has been reviewed favorably by the Environmental Defense. It's rated it as the most stringent of the parties. And the CCPA, which is the Canadian Centre for Policy Alternatives, has indicated that the Green Party, Fianna Fáil plan, is aiming too low. The other things that the NDP will do is cabinet decisions will be made through a climate lens. We'll price carbon and we'll set national targets and implement the cap and trade, which works very well with the carbon tax as well. We'll remove billions of subsidies from fossil fuels and we'll insist on enacting a enforcing a polluter pay system. We're also going to invest in transit, in clean energy, in energy-efficient commercial buildings, as well as help people retrofit their homes. These and other initiatives will move us away quickly from a dirty and a dying, costly industry that requires workers to work away in the tar sands, not in their home community. And we have plans to help with that as well. Thank you.
I'm going to focus a bit more on the challenge of the COP21 that opens on November 30th this year, 40 days after our election. We're going to have to hit the ground running, folks. We can't afford to waste a single minute. Once Harper is gone, we're figuring out a new parliament, a new government. I'll be on the phone with Mulcair and Trudeau immediately, whoever has the right balance for us to work with them and say, look, we've got a lot of work to do. We have to have much more ambitious targets than we have right now. And we need them before we go to Paris, not afterwards. We need to also pull together the A-team of Canadian diplomats and negotiators. We need to bring back the people who are respected around the world, which means, frankly, moving aside the negotiators that the rest of the world has grown to hate under Stephen Harper. We need to hit the ground running and go to the Paris negotiations, not to accept just any treaty, but to actually take the lead again to drive the world to deeper targets for a more ambitious treaty overall. I've been in the climate negotiations. I'm the only opposition member of parliament to have attended for years, and I can tell you, they are not impressing anyone right now. We are well short. The combined targets of every country so far fall short of avoiding 2 degrees, and preferably we should stick to 1.5. We have a lot of work to do. Once we get back from Paris, how do we make sure Canada hits those targets? Tough fees on carbon pollution, redistributed as dividends. The fee and dividend plan of the Green Party is the most costly and effective, plus energy efficiency measures. All 30% of our carbon pollution comes from buildings that are inefficient, plus investments in public transit, plus we have to ensure that we no longer have coal-fired electricity across Canada, and the Green Party is the only party in this election committed to stopping the growth in the oil sands so that we can move to a clean and green, sustainable economy.